thanks everybody for being here. My main focus with the Personalist Project and with my husband Jules is on trying to bring the insights of Christian personalism into the culture. So not to keep them in the ivory tower, merely academic, but to make them real in the world the way we live it. So I'm not going to be speaking so much about the intellectual monstrosity or the legal problem or the political history that Mark is here for that. My interest will be to try to zero in on the moral moment that we are facing. I think very few of us, never mind the wider public, but even very few Catholics, and I would even venture to say very few serious, ardent, faithful Catholics, have a really clear picture of exactly what's at stake at this moment. And obviously one reason for that is because from the Obama administration and the mainstream media, we are experiencing a deliberate obfuscation, right? They are consciously trying to mislead the public about what's really going on here. They're saying Mitt Romney wants to control or stop, limit women's access to birth control, and people are saying that's awful, women shouldn't be, you know, prevented from getting birth control, and so their sympathies are aroused that way, and like Mark said, it's a lie. So that's one reason for the confusion. But I think there's another reason, and that is the rhetoric on our own side is part of the problem. And let me try to make that clear. How many of us keep being told and keep hearing and being asked to repeat, it's not about contraception, it's about religious liberty. Don't we hear that very often? It's not about contraception. What is this doing? We're training ourselves to think, we're not against contraception, or we're not saying there's anything wrong with contraception. It's not about contraception. It's a religious liberty issue. That's one way that we get confused. Another way is we get brought up the analogy of kosher deli. This mandate, this HHS mandate, is like trying to force kosher delis to sell pork, right? Now, I understand the reason for this kind of rhetoric, and I sympathize with it. It makes some sense when you're in a pluralistic society and so on. But I do think, and I do worry, that it is framing the issue this way has the effect of downplaying the real evil that we're facing, and here's why. It makes it seem as if the problem here is just a discrete concern for a small subset of extremely religious Catholics, right? And people will say, and no one's forcing them to use birth control. If your church is against birth control or you don't want to use birth control, don't use birth control. What's the big deal? No one's saying you have to use birth control. You know, after all, Orthodox Jews don't think it's sinful for non-Jews to eat pork, right? Just like Catholics don't think it's sinful for non-Catholics to eat meat on Fridays during Lent. We're okay with that. The case is very different when it comes to birth control. Catholics oppose birth control not because religious authorities have forbidden it. We oppose it because we are deeply convinced that a birth control harms persons. It hurts people. It abuses people. That's what we cannot do. The whole mission of the Catholic Church in the world, right, the theme and the purpose and the aim of every Catholic institution and of every Catholic individual is, in a word, love. Why does the church set up hospitals? Why does the church set up schools? Why are whole orders of nuns established to serve the sick, to take care of the elderly? Why does Mother Teresa set up houses to serve men dying of AIDS? Why did St. Damien agree to go to the island and die with the lepers in Hawaii? Why did Barbara Kirby open the day room? Why does Father Gleason go to the hospital and to the hospice to be with dying people and sick people? Do they have to be Catholic people? No. They can be anybody. They can be anti-Catholic. They can hate us. We still do it. And why do we do it? We do it because it's, well, it's certainly not money, right? It's not prestige. That's not why we're doing it. And we're not even doing it because we're committed to taking care of our own. We're doing it because of love. We do it because we understand that each and every person is made in the image and likeness of God. Each, no matter how small or weak or broken, is a completely unique and infinitely precious human being. We understand that human life is a gift to be cherished and served, not abused, not manipulated, not degraded, not destroyed. This is the very heart of the whole drama of salvation history, right? The cosmic battle between the forces of life and love on the one hand, and death and abuse on the other hand. It's right there in Deuteronomy, I set before you life and death. This is how we Catholics understand the world. It's how we understand our own souls. It's how we understand our mission in the world. Jesus died to save us from death. Now our mission is to foster a culture of life and to build a civilization of love. That's the overarching mission of our lives, and we strive to make it even the theme of every single individual action of our lives, right? And it's the mission of every Catholic institution. And as St. Augustine said, he's the theme tonight. St. Augustine said, the first principle on that program is first, do no harm. This is the opposite of ends justifies the means, right? No matter how good a goal we have in mind, it's not okay to hurt people in order to achieve our goal. It's not okay to say, well, we'll allow three or four people to be abused because we can help 30 or 40 eat better tomorrow. We cannot collude with wrong. We can't subsidize the objectification of women and other injuries to the dignity of persons. We can't facilitate the killing of innocents. We can't betray our central vocation. So when the federal government uses the force of law to mandate that Catholic institutions and businesses provide birth control and sterilization and abortifacient drugs to their employees, it is, in effect, seeking to conscript the church into the service of the culture of death as a condition for our participation in society. This is not a small issue. And in my last minute or so, I wanted to point out something I was struck when I picked up the Archbishop's book, that one of the mottos that he chose for the book, which comes from the philosopher Henri Bergson, a French philosopher, and it is this: the motive power of democracy is love. What did Bergson mean by that? He means, obviously not majority rules or anything like that, he means that democracy too is grounded in the recognition of the worth and dignity of every individual. Every individual is a being with reason and free will, with rights and duties, a being to be respected and appealed to, not manipulated, to serve the ends of those in power. This mandate, and I would argue also Obamacare as a whole, is an abuse of persons, it's an assault on the Catholic Church, it's a betrayal of the American founding, and a repudiation of democracy. And I'll close with a quotation I found also in the book. It's by Charles Carroll, who is the only Catholic signatory of the Declaration of Independence. And it highlights, I think, how central a theme religious liberty was right at that time, and also how closely Catholics even then linked it with love. He says, quote, "To obtain religious as well as civil liberty, I entered zealously into the revolution. God grant that this religious liberty may be preserved in these states to the end of time, and that all who believe in the religion of Christ may practice the leading principle of charity, the basis of every virtue." End quote.